Good afternoon. Over the last couple of days, given so much of fog and the news about the smog in Delhi, yesterday or day before, Times of India carried a story that people are avoiding travel to Delhi. And also that a lot of people who live in Delhi are finding some excuse to go out of Delhi. But it's so heartening to see all of you coming from across the country, various parts of the country, for this conclave. So on behalf of SBI Funds and each one of us from the entire SBI group, a huge thank to each one of you for this, as our logo says, having this partner for life. So the SBI Mutual Fund is a partner for life, and this partnership with retirement funds is very, very close to our heart, is very special for us. Over the last 50 years or so, SBI has been, and if I can use the word, an integral part of EPFO, managing the EPFO money, our parent. But I mean, we were very fortunate 2 years back on 5th August 2015, when EPFO decided to first start investing into the equity, and SBI Mutual Fund got the exclusive mandate to invest in our Nifty and Sensex ETF. And I sincerely believe that I think we are deeply humbled. We are hugely privileged, honored to have this opportunity to serve millions of investors through those ETFs, through those investments. Our fund managers are here. In few minutes' time, they will join me in answering every question related to investments, related to market, related to how you are investing, both in the bond and the equity market. But I thought that first I'll thank you personally for coming here. And I think, as I said last year, that every part of the industry, financial services industry, has got its own association. So there is an association of mutual funds in India. There is an association of stockbrokers. There is an association of investment bankers. But surprisingly, despite this being such a large industry, I mean, mutual funds were much, much smaller till a few years back. We have grown very significantly in the last few years. But this industry is so large, but there is no, I'm not sure. Last year I spoke to a couple of people that there must be an association of retirement funds in India. While that is not there, but this is our own, I would say, small effort towards that partnership for life to have this kind of an conclave, this kind of a congregation. And this is not only a one-day affair. You would have seen over the last year how we have tried to interact, we have tried to have this word, to have this thought leadership from each one of you, how retirement fund industry over the next several years can grow in India, can take the challenges which are there, some of them which we discussed in the previous session, and the way forward. What we can learn from the global experience, what we can learn from our own experience, and how we see the future and build this industry which can really serve the needs of not millions, I mean a billion Indians over the next several decades. We also have a joint venture with Amundi Asset Management of France, which is the largest asset manager in Europe and one of the largest in the world, manages assets of more than $1 trillion, much bigger than I think all the funds in India put together. And they are also serving large number of pension and the provident funds in Europe and in several parts of the world. So we also get the benefit of their thought leadership, their experience in terms of what are the issues that this industry, pension industry, or the provident fund industry globally is facing, what kind of products they are looking at, what kind of innovations happening, what are the mistakes that some of the countries or some of the institutions have made, and what are the right lessons that we can learn from them. I'm very sure everybody came here, some of these questions would be there in your mind, right? I mean, what would be the typical questions about investing? I'm sure some of these investments would be there. How will equity investments impact our returns? We saw, I mean, some of you asking that question, but a lot of it was related to the accounting. But over a period of time, given that equity returns are volatile, how they will impact your returns on an annual basis? I'm sure a lot of people, and I saw the questions, in fact, we had some 50, 60 of them, and we shortlisted 20 to ensure that most of the points that each one of you have raised get answered by the by the dignitaries from the EPFO. But also the typical question, a lot of people, market itna bad gaya, kuch profit book kar le kya. Some people have done it, some few months back and are regretting it. But this is a typical question, market bad gaya, toh profit book kar le kya. So I'm sure I'll try to delve on that. Markets at a peak, what should I do? I mean, those who missed investing earlier and markets have been going up. I mean, today you got the news about India's rating upgrade a few days back. It was ease of doing business, or the news about the recapitalization of the PSU banks, and some or the other positive news flow has been there, and markets are touching a new high. So what should I do? Should I invest now? Should I wait for some time if I have missed? Should I try to time the market? How do we invest? I mean, should we wait till the 31st March? Should we do it every month? Should we try to time the market? I'm sure you also have, most of the people, and particularly not only those who are managing the provident fund money, but there are a lot of people in the room who also manage the treasury money and have the other investments. Are the valuations expensive? I mean, at that these valuations, should we invest in, and can equity market sustain these valuations? So maybe we'll spend a little bit of time on that. Also thought, should I look beyond the passive investment as the first step, the logical step for the provident fund industry in India was to invest into ETFs, and each one of you invested in Nifty and Sensex ETF. Some of you have invested in the actively managed fund, but what is the way forward? I mean, is ETF better? Are actively managed funds better? And how should we look at them? So some of these questions over the next few minutes, and I'll try to keep it as simple as possible, and all the tough questions you can ask the better experts that I have. Our head of fixed income, Rajiv Radhakrishnan, is here. The person who manages India's largest equity fund, the Nifty ETF, and also the Sensex ETF, and all our other ETFs. Ravi is here. A lot of our other experts are here. So all the tough questions you can ask them, and I'll try to, some of these questions I'll try to deliberate over the next couple of minutes. As I mentioned, when Mr. VP Joy was there, and last year I had exactly the same slide, that as the retirement fund industry in India, considering several transformations in the economy, transitions in the economy, several disruptions in the economy, just need to keep some of these things in back of our mind, and over the next several years, as we continue our dialogue, I think some of these things we must keep in mind as we build the industry. The demographic dividend that India has will remain very young for a long time. At the same time, the lifespan is increasing. There is a high likelihood that, I mean, you'll be surprised that when India got independence, the average age of an Indian, the possibility of him surviving beyond 34 years was, I mean, that's not the right way to put it. The average age was like 34 or 35 years in 1947. And the way in 50s people would have thought about Provident Fund, and today, because you are going to highly likely that you'll live beyond 70s and 80s, and if anybody who's born today or several of the people here, there's a high likelihood we cross 100 as the lifespan is increasing. So if we retire at 58 and 60, then we have to save for 40 years. And this is what the challenge several of the other countries that are going through, we need to keep in mind. A large part of the unorganized industry will move to the organized sector because of the GST, because of the digitization, because of the other efforts that are being made on the tax compliance side. So the industry size is likely to grow very, very substantially over the next few years. The change in social dynamics is very, very critical, because the way we think about our subscribers, or the, let's say, the workforce in India, and the large number of young people who are going to join today, they are very different in the way they think about life. So I never thought in my 20s, when I joined the workforce of India, of, let's say, having a car in my first or second year, or doing a foreign vacation in my first, second, or third year, or you know, taking a mortgage loan in my third or fourth year. But which is the case with people who are there in 20s and 30s. Their aspiration levels are very different. Their attitude about life is very different. Their risk appetite is very different. They may not be as content as some of the earlier people had. And when we think about the investment pattern going forward, I'm sure we need to keep that in mind. And also a big challenge in terms of annuity. Some of the people, and during the tea I was discussing, that because EPFO gives, or let's say the exempt PFs are delivering more than 8.5%, and when you get the money and when you go to the bank, the rates are much lower, so you would ideally like that money to remain in the PF so that you can earn that. But I think, Ajay, correct me, and beyond 3 years you can't keep that, and you can? Oh, so that's good, and people can earn higher returns. But we have to think about what to do with that money that you get on on that particular day or after that. And we are trying several things as an organization. You might have seen several of these holdings about SWP, systematic withdrawal plan, et cetera, to take care of that generation. I mean, people who are retiring now are getting a lump sum money, and how should they invest? But some of these things that we have to keep in mind. And then and also the intergenerational equity is very, very critical. Why we are earning 8.5 or 8.60 or 8.70 is because the interest rates were higher. Bonds were bought earlier at a much higher coupon, so you still have SDS money is not there or still there some part. SDS, which is earning very high, and then you have some of the other bonds. But then, and again, you invest in equity. The question of intergenerational equity, that today's subscriber, whatever money that he's putting in and what he's earning versus the future subscriber. So how accounting issues and the other fair valuation take that into account is very critical. So I just thought that I'll just leave some of these points. May not be exactly related with the market, but over the next couple of years, all of us put together, keep thinking about it. So the first question was, and I'll try to answer each of the questions that typically whenever we interact with most of you, we get that, and I've tried to keep it as simple as possible, and I'm sure we'll have a lot more lively discussion in a few minutes' time. How will equity investments impact our return? And I thought I'll give you a global perspective that large part of the world in Europe and in several parts of the other world like Japan and all, interest rates are negative. So, I mean, the interest rates over the last couple of years have been going down, and then, so, I mean, a few years back, several corporates issued bonds for 2 years or 3 years where there is a negative interest rate. So you give 100 rupees today to Nestle and you get 99 rupee few paise back after a few years. And think about it, I mean, the people who are there, of course, the inflation is also lower, but at some point in time, if inflation goes up, and then all the calculations, so endowment funds in US or in most of these places, who always think that our spending will go up by, let's say, 4 or 5%, they assumed interest rates at a certain level, they assumed equity returns at a certain level. But if they didn't have the equity investments, just think about it. Their earnings would have gone down so much and it would have been very difficult to cope up with the higher spending. So there the yields have been, so US 10-year yields have been going down over the last several years and equity markets have moved up. So whatever they lost in terms of the incremental accrual from a bond, they've made up through the gains in the equity market. In India, if I ask you one of the biggest reform that has happened in our country in last 3 or 4 years, which one that will come to your mind? The biggest economic reform that has happened in India. What will, konsa sir? GST, demonetization, or? Sorry? Savings rate, decontrol, what else? Somebody will say, I mean, let's say the, you know, the improved FDI regime. It's about Jan Dhan Yojana, it's about digitalization, financial inclusion, direct benefit transfer, real estate regulatory authority, so on and so forth, right? And that's the reason our ease of doing business as well as the credit rating, I mean, that has come down and credit rating has improved. But to me, I think the biggest reform that has happened in the last couple of years is the formation of Monetary Policy Committee. Before that, central bank used to, you know, wear several hats. Sometimes they think about the growth, sometimes they think about the bond market being the merchant banker for the government's borrowing program. Sometimes they look at the currency, sometimes they look at the inflation. Within inflation, a WPI or a CPI or core inflation, things keep changing. So, but the biggest dharma of a central bank is to ensure the purchasing power of the currency, which is like to ensure that the inflation remains under control. And that is what, I mean, India did some time back, where the central bank has a single as a Monetary Policy Committee has got a single objective, which is keeping the consumer price inflation at 4%, plus minus 2%, I mean above or below that, the central bank would answer to people that why the inflation is above 6 or why it is below 2%, 4% inflation. I mean, in India, we have seen over the last like several decades, we have these bouts of very, very high inflation. I mean, if the government is so committed, if government wasn't committed, they wouldn't have signed this, they wouldn't have formed the Monetary Policy Committee. So there is clearly a political, I would say, backing for the thought that we need to ensure that India has a period of nice. Nice is a term which is called non-inflationary continued expansion, that when your economy keeps growing but you don't get large inflation shocks. So if inflation shocks are not there, if India's inflation is likely to hover around 4%, that is the target for the central bank, and I'm sure the government would back it up through all their fiscal and the other measures, then rates are likely to remain around, remain at a lower level. So thinking that rates can substantially go up from these levels would be very, very tough, which we have seen historically. So we have seen, I mean, the direction of interest rates in India have been lower. Now there would, of course, I mean, there would be some short-term phenomena sometime, I mean, for whatever reasons, the food prices have gone up or oil prices go up, inflation would go up. But structurally, the government and RBI's thinking is that we need to ensure that CPI remains around 4%, and over a period of time, inflationary expectations of every Indian, which is not the case today, and that's why RBI has not been as aggressive in cutting interest rates as a lot of people think, or maybe a lot of people would want to, because they think that inflationary expectations in India are still very high. A man on the street thinks that prices are 10% badh rahe hain. Agar mera maid servant, meri maid servant hai, ya koi driver hai, to, aur koi bhi employee hai, usko lagta hai ki 10% to increment hona hi chahiye, because 10% inflation, usko aap bolo ki CPI 2 ya 3% ho gaya, he doesn't believe in that, right? So, but over a period of time, if 4% is the CPI inflation target for the Monetary Policy Committee, then over a period of time, man on the street will start believing in the 4%. So in that case, rates will remain low, and over a period of time, equity investment would become very, very important. And over a period of time, we have seen that, this is about India, but globally also true, that every year, a different asset class is the best performing asset class. There are years where fixed income does well, there are years where equity does well, there are years where gold does well, there are years where even keeping cash, I mean a money market, does well. And it's important that in any portfolio, and there is this very famous guy of Yale University, David Swensen, I mean he's considered as like father of modern portfolio management, portfolio construction. And then the theories for most of these endowment funds and pension funds is that have as diversified portfolio as possible. As many asset classes, as many segments or sub-asset classes as possible, because that ensures that volatility is lower and the returns are better. So that was like why equity, and I'm sure over the last couple of years, last year we discussed far more in detail, but I just thought maybe some of the points I will re-emphasize. Should I book profits from my equity investment? I think that if you continue with the, as we were discussing during the panel discussion, that we started with 5% and most of you would have reached the 15% of the incremental investment. On the stock or on the entire portfolio, the equity investment is still very, very low. So if equity delivers, let's say, I'm just putting a number. If let's say the fixed income is delivering 6.5%, 7%, if equity delivers 12, for that 5% to have a meaningful impact on the portfolio, equity has to become a meaningful part of the portfolio, right? I mean, if it is 5% of the incremental flow, which is again a fraction of your total portfolio, then it won't have that much of an impact. So till such time, it has to be rebuilt. Of course, you can sell, but again, what you are going to do is you just buy it back, because still your overall equity exposure is very, very low. And even at 15%, I think it will take some 11 or 12 years to reach to, let's say, like 10% of your total portfolio. So it will take several years of investment in equity to become a meaningful part of the total portfolio. We are only looking at that number, which is like the incremental flow and not the total investment. Now, this is a standard question. Markets are at a new high. Should I continue with my equity investment? I think last year I tried to explain this, that equity is like a perpetual bond without any coupon. Don't quote me that. I said equity is like a perpetual bond. Equity is a perpetual bond without any coupon. The only difference is that you get a fixed coupon, and if you are owning a PFC or REC bond, or if you have a deposit with SBI, I mean, you get whatever 8 rupee credited on 31st March or 1st April, here you don't get that credit. I mean, the market may go up or down. But over a longer period, what it mimics is the underlying corporate profit. Whatever profits that the corporate of India or the companies in your portfolio are earning, they will get reflected in the stock price. But they may not come in a linear fashion. What I've done is just, you know, connected two dots, 1979 when Sensex started at 100, and where it is today, it is like 330 times. So we are like 33,000 today. But it would have come with like a lot of volatility. There would be years where it delivered returns between 0 to 10%. There were years where it delivered 20%. There were years where it delivered 40% in a year. And there were years where it was minus 10 or minus 20. And it's very, very difficult to predict. At the beginning of the year, a lot of people thought, and that's why a lot of people are yet to invest in equity, because they thought after the demonetization, there would be GST, you know, implementation, there would be RERA, which may slow down the real estate industry a little bit. And because of that, market will go, you know, market will may actually have some bit of correction. But look at how the markets have moved. And it's very, very difficult to predict that. So just to complete that thing about the perpetual bond without a coupon, the long term is predictable, but in the short run, there could be lots of volatility, and it is very, very difficult, I mean, to really predict that and try to time in the market. What we need to keep in mind is it's 330 times in last 38 years, and can India, I'm not saying that it will be 330 times in next 38 years, but we can put our number, whatever expected returns from equity and what it can do, I'll show you in few minutes of that. And even like a market, so let's say the last, even let's say if I say that the overall macro outlook is looking good, all the reforms that have happened, they may have some impact in terms of impacting the growth in the near term, but structurally they are quite positive. Moody's is positive on India or whatever. But even in a structural bull market, there are several corrections. So 2002 when index was at 3,000 and 2009 when it was 21,000, in between there were several corrections of 10, 20, 30%. In fact, 2008 is an exceptional year in last 35 years history where it almost fell 60%, but ultimately 3,000 and 21,000, but between that there were several corrections in between that. Should I try to time the market? Easier said than done. I think the best way, which is what the EPFO has been doing very smartly and very systematically, if I invest, I mean the money at the lowest Sensex value for last, how many years I've taken the data for? 36 years. And if I was so unlucky that I invested every year at the highest Sensex level, but I just kind of did only one thing on the first day of the year. I'm sure if I do even more staggered, it'll be better. But if I didn't do anything, I just put the money on the first of the year, I mean, you did reasonably well. So it does over a very long period, and the retirement money is for a very long term period. Because I mean, these days in this era of WhatsApp and Twitter and everything, we get too swayed by the news flow. And I think important message that I want to leave with you is that this is such a long-term money, and we have to really think about the other changes that are happening in demography and the lifespan that we have to really think. And again, to complete that point, how the investments, I mean, done in a staggered manner over a period of time, as someone said that the compounding is the eighth wonder, that simple, how much like 1 lakh rupee invested every month at 8% becomes 14 crores, at 12% becomes 30 crores, and at 16% becomes 68 crore. A person who joins at the age of 30 and then retires at 60 at 30 years, this is the difference that just 8, 12, and 16 can make. And this is a lot more important than spending the time on trying to time the market. Are the valuations expensive? And I'm sure everybody, I mean, any market expert that you are meeting talks about the high valuation. How do you look at the valuation? This is the PE ratio, the price to earnings ratio of the Indian market. So if you compare with the historical standards, surely valuations are expensive. Market is not cheap. So what's real, but there are like a couple of other parameters. I've just put the PE where market looks the most expensive. In fact, if I look at the price to book ratio relative to the 2008 previous peak or 2000, then market is not as richly valued. It is lower than last time. Or let's say a market cap capitalization to the GDP ratio, it is not as much. But I think P is something where it looks overvaluation. So what is really driving the market? I'll try to keep it as simple and as short as possible, and we'll have more lively discussion in a few minutes. The three things that are really driving the market. The first is all the policy reforms that have happened. And the belief is that while, of course, the economic growth has slowed down, or maybe the corporate profits have not come for a variety of reasons, but every single thing which we just discussed a few minutes back and some of you highlighted, whether the GST, the single biggest taxation reform in our history, whether the real estate regulatory authority, whether the digitalization that we are doing in the economy, which is leading to several advantages in terms of whether it's a last mile delivery of the government or the direct benefit transfer where subsidy bill can go down very, very substantially, or the opening up of our economy, the ease of doing business. I can just go on. I mean, whether the the Uday scheme for the in the power sector. I mean, across all sectors, we have seen variety of reforms and over a longer period, which are getting acknowledged by most of the global agencies and the global investors. So that is the reason markets are at a high. The other thing is the global tailwind. So while Indian markets are at a new high, all other markets, I mean, if you look at the S&P 500 in US, that is also at an all-time high. You look at the European equities, they are also at a multi-year high. You look at the Japanese equity, you look at Chinese equity, you look at emerging markets. Globally, most of the economies are doing well, and because there is a lot of money in the system, interest rates are very low, and investors have no option but to invest more into the equities. Global economy has been doing pretty well in last few quarters. Actually, this has been one of the best periods for the global economic growth in a highly synchronized manner. For last, like since 2008, we never had a period where, right from US to Eurozone to Japan to China to all the other emerging markets, most of the economies are growing at a higher rate compared to where they were growing for last 5-7 years. And at the same time, because the inflation is low, central banks are not increasing interest rates. Interest rates are still very low, and that's why equity is looking attractive. So equity has been doing well. So while on Twitter and everywhere you keep hearing about, you know, the risk from North Korea or lots of tweets by you know, the leaders like Donald Trump, etc., but the investors are comfortable looking at the global economy and the cheap liquidity. And the third and probably the most important is the domestic flows that have been coming into our market, and we have never seen something like this. The pace at which the SIPs are getting opened up, so our industry almost now close to 6,000 crores is coming through monthly SIPs. So that's like 72,000 crores per annum. The mutual funds, EPFO, and all that, if you add the NPS, if you add the money which is coming into the ULIPs, etc., if you put together all this money, there is huge amount of money which is coming from the domestic investors into our market. Now, historically, our markets have always been very volatile, and that volatility is most of the time caused by some global factors. Something happened in Greece or Spain or Italy, some problem in the Italian banking system, because of that equity markets globally go down, or let's say the risk appetite is lower, foreign investors pull out money, our markets go down. Or something is done by US Federal Reserve or European Central Bank and FIIs pull out money, our markets go down. Something happens in China or Chinese currency, FIIs, foreign investors pull out money, and our markets go down. We have always been, we have always been dancing to the tune of global risk appetite, global liquidity, global interest rates, global factors. But it's completely changing. And a large part of these flows are very, very structural in nature. So, I mean, in last 2 or 3 months between July and October, foreign institutional investors sold more than $3 billion of equity, like more than 20,000 crores worth of equity, and our market didn't fall much. I mean, in fact, our market during that period touched an all-time high. Now, in my career, I've never seen something like that. In last 25 years, if foreigners sold even $1 billion of equity, even let's say today's $1 billion is like 6,500 crores, markets would have fallen 5-10%. But this is not happening now because of people sitting here or the domestic investors, that they have provided stability to the market. And that can go a long way. And that's it. I mean, some of these are the reasons that the market is higher. One of the important things to keep in mind, so what is the valuation? I mean, high PE ratio is high, price to earnings ratio. So price is higher, I mean, your index is higher, the earnings have not gone up as much. So let's say this year, YTD, let's say if Nifty has gone up 25%, but corporate earnings have not grown 25%. That's why the P ratio of the market has gone up. I'll try to put it very, very simply, that over the last 20 years or so, the corporate profits in India have grown at a CAGR of 13-14%. Our nominal GDP growth for last 20 years would have been 13-14%. Our corporate profits have also grown at 13-14%. And if you remember the number that I showed you, how our markets have delivered, they would be very close. And that was the point on equities, a perpetual bond without any coupon. Over a very long period, ultimately what the equity market would deliver is the corporate profits that the underlying companies deliver. In last 5 years or so, the profits have not grown as much. And corporate profits, so our GDP has grown in last 5 or 6 years, every year, even if last quarter we grew at 5.8%. It may be lower than the average of last few years, but the GDP has been growing every year, but the corporate profits have not grown as much for a variety of reasons. A lot of banks, like the PSU banks or the corporate lenders, had to take hit on the account of NPA provisioning, or let's say the overall private side capital expenditure has been low. People are not investing into new factories, new plants, and that's why companies in the industrial sector have not done well. Or let's say there are some challenges with the IT sector or with the pharma. For a variety of reasons, the profits in last 5 years have not been growing as much. In fact, the if you look at the earnings of Nifty or Sensex, they're like almost flat for last like 4 or 5 years. And that's why while market is going up, profits have not grown. Now there are two ways to look at it. One way to look at it is that, yeah, market has gone up, profits have not gone up, so it should come down. The other way to look at it, can it go down further? Can the aggregate corporate earnings in India, can they go down even more? So corporate profits as a percentage of India's GDP is at a multi-year low, probably the lowest ever. I don't think that 2.9% has ever been the case since we have this data for. And the average for last so many years is 5%. So total corporate profits, which ultimately, as I said, get reflected in the stock price, are like 5% of GDP, and they are like less than 3% of GDP. So the expectation is that this will mean revert. There will be a mean reversion. It's over a period of time in next few years, corporate profits will grow, and then valuations will look reasonable. Not necessarily that they happen in tandem. There could be a period where, let's say, market go down a little bit, profits don't come. You may have a period where profits come and market don't, or markets go up, the profits don't come, and you have a period where profits go up and market doesn't go up. But over a period of time, next few years, if valuations remain here, then what should one expect in terms of return is at what pace corporate profits in India can grow. So when you invest in Nifty, you invest in India's top 50 company, which is, you assume that is a reflection of the overall corporate India, their profit should go in line with the historical range at some point in time, and that should get reflected in the stock price. Also, there is another way to look at it, is that why the equity valuations are higher, that when you were getting 9-10% return in your, let's say, fixed deposit or your SDS or, I mean, the other people, I mean, your expectation of returns from equity market, if someone says that 18-20% will come, or if it will come above, then you will see equity, right? If the rate is 6%, then your expected return from equity should also be lower. You can't expect the same return from equity while your inflation and interest rates have come down. So your return expectations from equity also has to come down. So if there is a 20 PE, that's like 5% earnings yield, the inverse of that. So if the interest rates were 10%, maybe a 12-13 PE would look like higher. But if interest rates are 5 or 6%, then one can justify even a 17 or 18 PE. So that also has to be kept in mind, because the equity, so you get the returns from the risk-free bond, then you get returns from AAA, which is slightly higher, then you get returns, let's say, from the lower rated corporate, then from equities, you need a little bit of risk premium. So as the base curve, as the base yield on the sovereign keeps changing, I mean, all the other yields or the return expectation need to change. One of the question would be, should we look at, so that's all in the market, and we can have more discussion with experts, and we can have that later. Should we look beyond the passive investment, as most of you have invested in the Nifty and Sensex? I'm sure there would be some more indices. There are already a couple of other index that we offer. We have a Next 50, which has done very well in last couple of years, far better than the Nifty. When you have BankEx, you'll have BSE 100, couple of other indices. And what we are trying to do is, you are exactly replicating. I mean, I'm sure everybody is aware, but just I thought I'll take 2 more minutes and I'll tell you why I'm explaining that again, which is the new categories that may emerge over a period of time, particularly which would be interesting for you. I mean, they are like very transparent. You know what you are buying when you put money in an ETF. I mean, at any point in time, you can look at the NSE's website or BSE's website and you know what is the valuation of that. You don't have to check our NAV, and every day, every minute, you know how your investments are doing. So, I mean, we are exactly replicating, and that's why it's very, very cost efficient. Bulk of the money today is in these indices. The active investing, what we are trying to do is, so let's say same fund. So we have a blue chip fund or a Magnum equity. What we are trying to do there, through an active management, which is like, so you have a underlying benchmark. So blue chip, the benchmark is BSE 100. But in BSE 100, the weight of Reliance Industries may be 5%, the weight of HDFC Bank may be 8%, the weight of, or 7%, the weight of Infosys may be 4%. You are taking individual call on some of these sectors and stocks. And what you are trying as a fund manager, how can I deliver a better return than what Nifty Fund is delivering? And how are you doing it? By doing, actively you are taking some bets that, let's say IT may not do this better this year, banking may do well, so I'll have more exposure to banking and less to IT. I may have more exposure to industrials and less to, let's say, pharma or so on and so forth. Or I'll have stocks where the weight in my portfolio is different than what is there in the underlying index. And over a long period of time in India, fund managers, like several of our funds have been in existence for 15, 20 years, they have shown alpha. Alpha is the return over the underlying benchmark. They have shown consistently. So if you look at some of the funds, and I'll come to that, I'll take 2 more minutes there. There could be a third strategy, which is somewhere between passive and active. And this is one of the highest growing category in the world for most of the pension funds, which is the smart beta investing. So they retain the benefit of the basic style of a passive fund, that they will replicate an index, but that index will be different. So the typically index that you have invested are, most of the people would have invested in Nifty and Sensex, right? So you have invested in Nifty, same 50 Nifty stocks. How I invest in Nifty, or how the Nifty is constructed, is based on the market capitalization of each company. So if there are 800 crores outstanding shares of SBI, into the stock price of SBI 310, that is the market capitalization of the State Bank of India. How much of it is free float, which is traded in the market, because Government of India may own 65%. So the index provider will look at 35% of that value of the SBI, and accordingly, they will have weight of, let's say, 2.8% for SBI. Let's say HDFC Bank will have more, ITC may have higher than the other, or let's say any company which is the lowest company, Ravi's here? The lowest is which one? MRF? No, the, not Z. Which will be the lowest in terms of market cap in Nifty? One of the stock would have, so accordingly, weight is decided. What we are doing in smart, I'm trying to simplify as much as possible. What we may do in smart beta, so I'm just giving a few examples. Instead of creating this weight based on the market capitalization, same 50 stocks of Nifty, but the weight could be based on maybe a dividend yield. So a company that gives higher dividend to investors may have a higher weight than a company which gives lesser dividend. It could be based on valuation. Companies where P/E ratio or price to book is higher, they have a lower weight. Companies that are cheaper, they may have higher weight. It could be based on volatility of the stocks. Stocks that fall or go up more, or they are more volatile, that if that is considered as risky, you have lower weight. And stocks that exhibit lower volatility, you have higher weight for them. And I've tried to kind of make it simple, but there are several variants of the smart beta. That is known as smart beta. Passive investing ETF is beta investing. You are just getting the market return, but within the same market return. And once the index is decided, and which is completely rule-based, a fund manager cannot change that. In case of a blue chip or a Magnum equity, a fund manager will decide ki mereko kitna Infosys lena hai, mereko kitna SBI lena hai, kitna ONGC lena hai, NTPC lena hai, ya nahi lena hai, PGC kab lena hai, bechna hai. Isme the weight is based on a rule, but that rule is very different the way a Nifty or Sensex weight is. This is something which is, we are trying to deliver better returns. The better could be in form of lower volatility because you're looking at less risky stock. Better could be because these are cheaper stocks and you assume that stocks that are priced cheaply, they will do well, or variety of other factors. There could be I mean, these are based on quality, they are based on like value, they are based on moment. The momentum is like the stocks that are going up, you assume that they will keep going up more. The stocks that have not been moving up, they may not move. I mean, that is also one of the strategy momentum, because if, let's say, there is a reason that a stock is going up, and if you're buying that, you'll keep, taking advantage of that momentum. There could be variants of these. So your underlying portfolio would be similar to where you are allowed to invest, but they will be invested very differently. And I assume that in the next couple of years, there will be a lot of innovation on this side. So this is somewhere between the passive investing and the active investing. So that's a bridge between that. As I said, that over a longer period, because I'm in fund managers, of course, there is a risk. I mean, if let's say, if I have, I'm just taking a name. So let's say, if let's say pharma stock has gone down, I have more pharma stock, in that period, the fund will underperform the benchmark. But over a longer period, I mean, there is a history that the funds have done better than the benchmark. And the same thing, the advantages of active versus passive investing is that you assume that with the skill set of the fund manager, with the research resources, you do better than the market. And I give you a very classic example and very interesting example of last 1 year, where the 10-year, actually this was made a few days back, and after that, of course, the yields have moved up a little bit. But just to give you a very interesting example of the 10-year bond yield was 6.80 a year back. It was 6.80 a few days back, and we took exactly that period, 680 to 680. So it has remained there. But in a gilt fund, gilt funds have returned almost 9% in the same period. How they did it? Maybe when rates fell to 6.10 after the demonetization, they sold some securities. When yields went up again to 680 or 670 a few months back, they bought it. Maybe when it fell to 645, they sold it. Again, they bought it. So that's called active management. So both in equity and fixed income, you try to do that and try to generate better returns. So over the last 5 years, if you look at, even the gilt funds have delivered better than the core portfolio of the. What you should look at, I mean, while investing into a passively managed fund, I mean, of course, you need to take the appropriate right index, the size of the ETF. Different indices will have different basket size depending on your investment, the operational efficiency, which I'm sure over a period of time who have dealt with us, the tracking error, and I say it with great pride, and the team has done the wonderful job. I mean, Ravi has done an amazing job in terms of the tracking error. We have the lowest tracking error, both in Nifty and Sensex in India by a margin, and this is one of the lowest in the world also. I mean, we have really built huge expertise in terms of ETF, and thanks to the blessings of EPFO when we started, I mean, internally, we were very clear that there is a huge sense of responsibility, there is a huge sense of we are managing somebody else's money, and we have to ensure that the mandate that has been given to us, and then we stand true to that trust, and as I stand in front of you on behalf of the of him and the team, we have really done very well. So that is very important. The way risk is managed, I mean, there are rebalancing within the index, there are a couple of other things that happen, I mean, of how each fund house is managing the risk, and we have a large risk team, and then a couple of, I'm sure, the other aspect of which index you really want to buy. Similarly, when you choose the equity funds, you have to look at the pedigree of the fund house, the processes of the fund house, you have to look at the risk management team, and the way they have stood the test of time over a longer period, the consistency of performance across market cycles. There would always be periods where, if you are actively managing, there would be period where you are outperforming 5%. There are periods where you are underperforming 2%. But what is more important is having a longer term orientation and consistency in that period and the expense ratio. I'll just maybe last two or three points I want to leave with you. As I mentioned, some larger issues with the overall industry that we need to grapple with or think about. Similarly, in each one of your organization, as over a period of time, some gentlemen asked about, can we invest in AIF? Some gentlemen asked about, can we invest in Basel III or Tier 1 bond? There's one Tier 1 bond that trades at 820. There is another one which trades at 1080. Over a period of time, there would be new kind of securities. You will have these InvITs, Infrastructure Investment Trust. You will have these REITs coming in. Globally, REITs is one of the biggest asset class for the pension funds. And as I said, that the more diversified the portfolio is, better it is. So if you can get exposure to real estate in some form, in the REITs form, which is like financialized, you don't have to worry about the how to manage that project or something, but somebody is offering that real estate investment trust. And all of that, so over a period of time, it will become relatively more, I would say, complex. As we also move towards the unitization, then obviously the volatility in the portfolio will go up, the return differential will go up depending on where you invested, and that's why it's important to build those capabilities. I mentioned some of these things last year. I think the diversification is critical. Having the risk management as you invest across asset classes, across fund managers, across securities, across sectors, how to have those risk budgets, and how do you monitor that those risks on a live basis. The cost will become a very, very important part between you managing it, hiring the managers, and then are they adding the value to you, and then the whole monitoring and the management mechanisms. I just thought a couple of things: building the right investment team with the right skill set, having the right risk management framework in place, the external resources that you need. I mean, all the other service providers with whom you have to deal with, a lot of things might be in-house, but as the size and complexity increases, there would be several providers for you. The digital tools, maybe a lot of things might be manual today or on Excel sheet, but as you have variety of things and you have to calculate the NAV like the way mutual funds do. And the advantage is that mutual funds have been doing it for, like, this is our 30th anniversary of SBI mutual funds. So we have been doing it, a lot of these things, and would be very, very happy and very pleased to engage with each one of you on most of these aspects, that how do we put some of these things in place as you move towards the fair valuation and the other analytics and putting the right operations team in place. And at our end, I mean, we offer the mutual funds, we offer the portfolio management services, where, let's say, some of the people who don't want to invest directly into the fund, but into the advisory services, where we can invest on your behalf. Some of my team members will discuss that, and over a period of time, there would be alternative investment funds as well. I'm sure, I mean, standing in front of you and looking at the partnership and the trust that you have, that despite the smoke and fog, everybody has come. I don't have to talk too much about the strength and the group advantage of the SBI, but a lot of customized solution, and over a period of time, and this is, as I mentioned, that different kinds of securities, different kinds of asset classes, and as the underlying portfolio changes compared to the way it has been managed, I think some of these things that we can do for you, and some of my colleagues will explain a little more. So right from the asset allocation to execution to updating you on the market on a regular basis to servicing each aspect of your portfolio to regular monitoring and managing it, a complete end-to-end solution that we can provide you. Again, I would like to personally thank each one of you for all the trust that you had, the money that you have given us, and as I keep saying, that this is a very, very noble job. You are the trustee of the subscribers. The money that you have, very similarly, when even a paisa from that, when you give it to us, we have the same sense of trusteeship that this is somebody else's money, and the ultimate beneficiary may be a coal mine worker in some place, or your Asansol and different places from Assam tea worker. This is a money for his or her retirement, and it's very, very important that we do the right job, we take right action for each paisa of that money. Thank you so much.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.